problema, das ist Problema. Let me see to that.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Just inviting you to compose yourself as we get ready to worship. We are gathered today to reflect on the life of retired Superintendent Kevin Canute Knight, retired Senior Superintendent Kevin Canute Knight. And so as we come to worship God, We trust that our hearts will be richly blessed. We will be empowered to face our tomorrows. And so I'm going to invite us to stand as we share in the singing of the opening hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Please stand as you are able. Seated, please, as I invite Pastor Dexter Dennis to come, first chaplain, to come lead from here. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The Lord be with you. Today we are assembled to pay our last respects to a life well lived and a life, I would say, well served. Senior Superintendent of Police retired, Kelvin Knight. Today marks a very sad day in the lives of his colleagues, family members, and by extension, the Jamaica Constabulary Force. But I'm also reminded that even on a sad day, we serve a good God. So while we are here to grieve, and grieve we must, I want you to keep hope alive in your heart that the memories, the times of joy, the times of indifference, and all the aspects of life will be so pleasing as you think fondly of your loved one. Today, allow me to acknowledge and recognize the presence of the following persons: our host minister, Reverend Wayne Smith, Reverend Astor Carlisle from the Webster United Church, Reverend Devere Nugent, East Queen Street Baptist Church, Bishop Harold Blair, Faith Cathedral Deliverance Center, and I can't recognize myself. While we are going through the program, we want to also recognize the presence of the officers that are here. Firstly, let me recognize Deputy Superintendent of Police, Mr. Winston Milton, commanding officer for the Trelawney Division, and also in this capacity will be representing the Commissioner of Police, Major General Anthony Anderson. Other senior officers that are present, all the rank and file members, those on the inside and those on the outside giving support to this occasion, we recognize. Members of the District Constables Association, all retired members, and at this time I'm going to be asking all retired members to stand. Put your hands together for them. You may be seated. And while you're taking your seats, let me also say thank you for your continued service. Thank you. Thank you. The family members that are present, indeed, this day is a day we hope would never come. It's a day that we will always remember. But in this time, I invite you to also don't lose sight of the hope that we have in our Lord and Savior. Those who are viewing via the varied social media platforms, welcome and acknowledgement to you as well. And everyone that is here as supporters, well wishers, be acknowledged at this time. We move into our program, into the segment of tributes. The first tribute will be the commissioner's tribute. This will be done by Deputy Superintendent of Police, Mr. Winston Milton, commanding officer for Trelawney, followed by the tribute from the members of the PASS, Members Association of the JCF Chapter 1. This will be done by Mr. Harris Daly, president of the chapter, followed by the Trelawney Division, then retired Superintendent Alwyn Brown, then Mr. Alvin Gallimore, and then Mrs. Dossett Craigton. We will go in that order as best as possible. At this time, the Commissioner's message.
Good morning, Church. I'll now read a tribute from the Commissioner of Police. It is with deep sadness that I lead the JCF family in mourning the loss of a retired colleague, Mr. Kelvin Kenyute Knight, Senior Superintendent of Police, who served the following divisions: Trelawney, Kingston Eastern, Portland, St. James, Hanover, Westmoreland, Areas 1, 4, and 5, the Inspectorate Branch, and St. Andrew's Central. Kelvin Kenyute Knight enlisted in the Jamaica Constabulary Force on May 18, 1966, and he retired on October 31st, 2005. He delivered 39 years of service to the people of Jamaica and received 9 commendations. To Kelvin's spouse, Pauline, his children, Kelvin Jr., Dwight, Michelle, Patrice, and Denise, his siblings, Barrington, Richard, Owen, Newton, Dossett, Apsie, Bonthia and other bereaved family members, please accept our deepest sorrow for the loss you have endured. We pray that God will comfort you as you journey through this time of grief. As we mourn his passing, let us pledge to carry on the fight of reducing crime in Jamaica, thereby making our communities safer. You will always remain in our heart, Mr. Kelvin Canute Knight, Senior Superintendent of Police. May his soul rest in peace. Major General Anthony Anderson, CD, Commissioner of Police.
My brothers and sisters, good morning. On your program, you would have seen that the tribute should have been done by Stedman Roach, a musical tribute. But unfortunately, he's not around. And I, being the president of the Association of Past Members, it falls squarely on my shoulders. So, the Bible tells us in Job 14 and verse 1 that man that is born of a woman is of a few days. Life is full of trouble. I cannot say that for Mr. Knight. However, let me, on behalf of the Association of Past Members of the Jamaica Constabulary Force Chapter 1, express condolences to the family and friends of Senior Superintendent Kelvin Knight, retired. I would have my first encounter with Mr. Knight in the 70s, when I used to travel into Trelawney to work at the Egg Agricultural Show. And then after the show, Mr. Knight would travel with us into Hanover to stay with his wife. To me, he was a man of few words, but whenever he speaks, there was weight in the words. I myself was not a talkative person, so although I would have met Mr. Knight in the 70s, I did not know much of him because we seldom speak to each other. It's like we were traveling but not speaking. However, in 1998, I was transferred to Westmoreland Division. Mr. Knight was the commanding officer there, and I was the operational officer. So at this time, we had to speak to each other. I can remember one morning I went into, I think it was the first morning, I went into his office, saluted him, I reported to him, and he spoke with me. And his final words were, "Mr. Daly, you come to Westmoreland, it's like hopping onto a moving train." And I knew exactly what he meant by that. No time for joking. Is that I should get myself together and be ready to work. However, Mr. Knight was a gentleman, and that he would have directed me in the right direction. Tell me what should be done and what not to be done. As was mentioned, he would have served the force and by extension Jamaica, and we are proud of him, although we are here mourning today. But let us not mourn as if there is no hope, for in fact there is hope in King Jesus. May his soul rest in peace and light perpetually shine on him. Thank you.
It was Sir Wilfred Greenfield who said, and I quote, "The service we render to others is really the rent we pay for our room on this earth. It is obvious that man is himself a traveler, that the purpose of this world is not to have and hold, but to give and serve." There is no doubt in my mind that the late retired senior superintendent of police, Kelvin Knight, did serve. He was one with compassion who gave and served his country with utmost pride and dignity. He was a man of honor. He had a genuine love for people, and that, in my opinion, made him exemplary at what he do, because in policing, you must interact with people on a daily basis to be effective at what you do. He had a zeal and a passion for policing like none other that I came across. I met Mr. Knight in the early 1990s as a young member of the Jamaica Constabulary Force when he came to Hanover as the then commanding officer for the parish. Under his leadership, I was promoted twice. I was placed firstly to Sandabay as a constable to perform the role of a sub-officer in charge traffic for that police precinct. Later on, I was promoted and then transferred to Lucy as a corporal to perform the role of a sergeant as a sub-officer in charge traffic for the parish of Hanover, and all this under the command of the then superintendent, Kelvin Knight. I was given a mantle because he saw the potential in me. You see, notwithstanding that he was an officer of the Jamaica Constabulary Force, he was welcoming to all rank, all of his subordinates and peer with whom he served. He was a leader who made others better. He listened, he guided, he empowered. He see perspective in you and he believe in it, and he nurture and cause it to grow. He had a warm and caring personality, and because of this, our bond grew. You see, Mr. Knight's home became mine. And as I was saying when I met with the family, Mrs. Knight and his daughter, Michelle, and son, and others via remotely, we, back in those days, used to travel regularly to Kingston on what we call express duty as traffic people to take documents into Kingston. The technology is not as we know it today. But then, to me in particular, it was easier for me to travel from Lucy to Orange, Dumfries, Wakefield, into Bounty Hall, and around the back of Mr. Knight's house. Because, you see, there I'm sure I have the guaranteed breakfast. And I was never, ever disappointed. When I visited with the family, Mrs. Knight said to me, because I drove around the back, I'm kind of used to the back. She said to me, come through the back. Family entered through the back. I laughed because it was ironic. I always entered through the back. You know, initially, I used to have breakfast being made for me. But then, as time progressed, I started to make my own breakfast. That was the man, Mr. Knight. So when she told me about a groundsman at the station, that was elevated by Mr. Knight to the status of family member and actually had dinner on the family table, I knew then that it was not only me. This was the person, Mr. Kelvin Knight. He was a people person. And I think that was what caused him to grow the way he did in the organization that he had served. SSP Knight was a mentor. He was a friend. He was a father. He was a selfless individual. To his wife, Pauline, his children, Kelvin Jr., Michelle, Dwight, Denise, and Patrice, I say to you, mourn you must, but mourn not like those who are without hope. Mr. Knight may have transitioned, but trust me, he lives on through the lives of those persons we had touched. I am who I am today because of the impact that he had made on my life. May heaven's gate open for him, just as he opened his home and welcomed me. Until we meet again, sir, I say, may God hold you in his palm, and as I bid you farewell, bon voyage until we meet on the other side.
Morning, everyone. I'm just going to do one verse as per request of the wife of this song. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, but forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. There be no sorrows there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no more pain, no more parting over there, but forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day that will be. Jesus, I shall see when I look upon his face, the one who saves me by his grace. Then he takes me by the hand and lead me to the promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Praise the Lord.
Members of the clergy, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and if there are boys and girls in the congregation, good morning. You know, as I sat there, I said to myself, why did this family do this to me? Having listened to retired Deputy Superintendent of Police, Mr. Daly, and the commander for the Trelawney Division, Mr. Winston Milton, I said, why did they do that to me? It's not an easy thing to speak after such eloquent persons have spoken. You'll agree with me. Nevertheless, I've given my commitment to the family and I'm going to honor it. On the 1st of October, 1981, I was initially posted in this division, the Trelawny division. During that first month as a probationary constable, I was required to attend what used to be a vibrant Trelawny Sports Club meeting. Very vibrant. At the time, the late Felix McLeod was at the helm. Never had anything behind his name, Mr. Milton. But he too was very eloquent. Very eloquent. Now, among the persons in attendance at that meeting, that first sports club meeting for me, was were, of course, station managers. And among the station managers was one who stood out to this very day, Mr. Kelvin Canute Knight. He never spoke excessively. He was not an excessive talker, just like what previous persons have said. But when he spoke, believe you me, I was most impressed as a youngster. He was very eloquent. And I said, boy, I wish I could get the chance to serve with this gentleman. 1 year passed. It never happened. But you know, out of evil comes forth good. In March of 1983, I was transferred to Duncan's police station, where he served as a station commander. Now, the first case that I investigated after I was transferred to Duncan's was a shock-breaking and larceny case committed at Hillside Enterprise. That's the bakery that used to be located just as you pass the clock and go up a little, just beside Carib Steel's Hardware. A youngster by the name of Morris Scott, O.C. Pongo, broke in the bakery and stole a number of items, a number of things. And I don't know if I should say fortunately or unfortunately, I was deputed to do the investigations. Mark you, I was still a probationer, you know. And there was a detective in the person of Errol Coley, the late Errol Coley, who was assigned to the CIB at Duncan's. Anyway, I was more than happy for the experience. Now I visited the scene of the breaking, and I observed something. And based on something shared with me by an eyewitness, I observed a hole in the roof. It was zinc, it was made of zinc. A little section of the zinc was pulled away. I returned to the station, and as good police practice, not like nowadays, Mr. Milton, I reported to the then Sergeant Knight. He took me in his office, sat me down, and he said, Mr. Brown, this is how you're going to write your statement. And he dictated it. He said, I saw a hole in the roof large enough to admit the body of an adult. And guess what? I took Pongo before the court, and he was given a 3-month sentence, thanks to Mr. Knight. In my personal and professional association with Mr. Knight, I found him to be a friend. Just like what the previous speaker said, I don't know if they were looking at my notes. I found him to be an excellent counselor. I found him to be a true mentor. I had a DTSO like everybody else, you know, in the person of Ligon Robinson. But what this man did for me, honestly, I don't think I can thank him enough. I found him to be a father, Mr. Milton. I found him to be a confidant. And in the interest of time, I'm going to use the letters of his first name to see if I can describe who Mr. Kelvin Kenyute Knight was really to me. Mr. Knight was knowledgeable. And this knowledge was not merely confined to law and police procedures. He had a wealth of knowledge. And you know why? He was well-read. Well-read. Mr. Knight was kind. I may not have gotten breakfast as often as you, but my Sourland cake never missed me. Mr. Knight was exemplary. He was the epitome of a true professional, K.K. Knight. Mr. Knight was loyal. Loyal to the JCF. Loyal to the staff at Duncan's. To the extent where, while it is the ideal to be intrinsically motivated, I remember when they had a spate of break-ins in Silver Sands. We sacrificed our days off because of what? The loyalty he showed to us and to the organization. Mr. Knight, while he was loyal to the organization, he was a consummate family man. And that is what I love about him. And you see, all this good treatment that was meted out to him in these last days, I am more than convinced, I'm overly convinced, that it was because of the loyalty to family as well. Because some of us make the mistake, you know, Mr. Wilby, to work, and turn our backs on our families. And in later days, we suffer. Mr. Knight was a visionary leader. He had great vision. I often tell his wife, every time I visit, I say, Mrs. Knight, the little cottage that I now occupy and call home, had it not been for Mr. Knight, I would not be there. Because, yes, I was married, and I decided that I wanted a roof over my head and I wanted a good roof. But then, where the house was constructed never belonged to Alwin Earl Brown. It belonged to my wife. And Mr. Knight said to me, Brownie, since you have a piece of land, see if you can get a little house. And I took his advice. I went to St. Anne's Bay at the National Housing Trust then, and I got a build and own land loan. And thanks to Mr. Knight, he was visionary. Mr. Knight was of impeccable integrity. Nobody could bribe him, and if they attempted, they wouldn't be successful. That was the Mr. Knight I know. Ladies and gentlemen, I really miss him. His family, his wife can tell you, every week we keep in touch. Every morning we share greetings. I know that Jamaica has lost an excellent human being. But guess what? I am aware of his religious convictions. I am aware of his religious commitments. And as somebody who believes in what the Bible says, I know that Mr. Knight is only sleeping. And if I, Alwin Earl Brown, remains faithful, Then we will meet again, Mrs. Knight. I know he has given invaluable service, not only to Trelawney, but Jamaica in general. I know we owe him and his family a debt of gratitude. And I'm going to say at this moment, thanks to you, the Knight's family. May God continue to bless you, Mrs. Knight, and family, as we look forward to meeting with Mr. Kelvin Kenyute Knight later. Thank you very much.
Good morning, family and friends. I am here to give a tribute on behalf of Kelvin's siblings, three sisters and four brothers. One is unavoidably absent. Kelvin was the number one. He was the first child. He made this very clear in action that he was boss. Growing up, he would give orders which had to be obeyed. Although he was strict, he was caring, loving, kind, and very considerate. He was always displaying leadership skills, suggesting career paths as he observed our talents. Those who chat a lot, he would say, "You would be well as a lawyer or a teacher. You would do well as a builder," he would say to those who use certain tools well. He shared with us how he had to work hard with Papa, taking breakfast to him on his farm and riding the mule with farm products back home. Then he had to get ready for school. He would bathe in the river nearby, swimming and diving and also fishing. He loved to play cricket. And they used to call him Tony Lack, as he was a very fast bowler. And if you hit his ball, he would come harder the next time around. He did well in school and did the police test and was accepted as a cadet, as he was too young. Then he advanced to the JCF as a constable. From there, it was up to SSP. He worked in several parishes, but in Trelawney, he met his wife, whom I think God picked for him. I don't think he could have made a better choice. Pauline, and they built their home in Bounty Hall, where they lived until the time of his death. He did not forget us in Hillside St. Thomas. He would visit with his family and would sit together. We would sit together for hours, and he would go down memory lane and remind us of the things he did with us. One joke that stands out was when he was always getting flogging from Mama and did not know how to get away. Then one day, his little brother told him, "Always leave your shirt front open. Then when mama holds you, just pull out your hands and leave the shirt with her." That worked for a little while. Kelvin loved his siblings and wanted the best for them. He gave financial support to us. He took Ansby, Newton, and Borinthia to Trelawney to live with his family. To date, Ansby is now married and is still in this side of the island. Newton also is married, built his home in Clarkstown, and now resides in Cayman Islands with his family. Borinthia migrated to New Jersey, where she is living with her family now. He was always encouraging us to be ambitious and to work hard. He gave starter projects to some of us, bought animals like pigs, cows, and chicken for rearing. He's also give us good advice, and then he would follow up on us whenever he comes to visit. Since his illness, we visited him, and most of us during his illness, we visited him. We prayed with him, and one could see the joy in him, even though he was ill. We loved him and his family, and we know he loved us, and he loved God, and is safe in his arms. May his soul rest in peace. Amen.
All right, while Mr. Gallimore is making his way to the stage, let me use this opportunity to welcome the recognize the following persons. Bishop Plummer, welcome. Bishop Bernard and Minister Robinson. Also, let me recognize Superintendent of Police, Mr. Richard Hilton, Crime Officer for Area 1. Recognition to you, sir. Other senior officers that may have joined, recognition to you. Also, let me recognize the presence of Reverend Courtney Walters, former or retired assistant chaplain for Area 1. Recognition to you, sir. At this time, we will have Mr. Gallimore.
A very good morning. I met Kevin when we were 16 years old, and I don't think we ever outgrew those childhood days. He continued to amaze me. And in one of our meetings, we hadn't seen each other for about 12 years. And one Saturday morning, we were going to Negril for a weekend of cricket. That's the IRFM cricket team. We're going to Negril for a weekend of cricket. And just outside of Negril, we ran into a police check. And I looked through the windscreen and I saw this superintendent, neatly clad, clothes fit him very well, looked good. And I thought I knew whom he was, but I wasn't sure. I hadn't seen him for years. So I asked the constable who pulled us over, "Who was that? What's the name of that superintendent?" He told me his name is Knight. I said, KK Knight? He said, yes. Now, this man has always amazed me, and to see this man in a superintendent's uniform, having not seen him for quite a few years, I had to display it. I couldn't just say it. Let me first of all tell you that our main sporting event was boxing. And I'm not talking about watching boxing on television. I'm not talking about reading about it. I'm talking about going into the ring and boxing. So when he said this was KK Knight, I had to display it more than just say it. So I jumped off the bus and began shouting in some Muhammad Ali terms, "Dynamite, KK Knight. He has power on his left, power on his right. Hit you once, you sleep for the night. But I am Muhammad Ali. I float like a butterfly. I sting like a bee. George can't hit what George can't see." And he turned around, recognized the lyrics, recognized it was Muhammad Ali lyrics, recognized me, and he tightened his cap, sort of tilted the face back, and he began to spar towards me, meeting in the middle. I started to go towards him, and we started to throw punches from out there, and we were there, and motorists passing, they stopped, hardly come out of the car. Some motorists that were leaving, reverse came out of the car. The policemen on their different posts, everybody came to ringside. They're gonna see the fight of the century. And myself and KK Knight, we went on until we got close, and I kept shouting, "Man, KK Knight, him? He has power on his left, power on his right. Dino might hit you once, you sleep for the night. But I am Muhammad Ali. I float like a butterfly. I sting like a bee. George can't hit what George can't see. This kid is brash and he's got endurance. You plan to fight him, increase your insurance." And the people said, "This is a fight of the century." But those were not the days of the cameras where everybody has a camera. But if those were the days, we would have been under camera for quite a few days. But I tell you something, how it all happened, KK came to Port Royal when I was a cadet. I was there like about 5 months before him. He came there as a cadet. And that morning that he came there, we were just about wrapping up our boxing lesson with Archie Moore, former heavyweight champion of the world. He was training us to box. And KK lit up. His cup, he was drinking from his saucer, his cup overflowed, that's what he wanted to see. So later that day, he came to me and he asked me if I could get him involved in the boxing. This was a very thin kid, not short, but he was very slender, no muscles at all. And I said, "Well, this kid is incredible." Anyhow, I went to Sergeant James, and Sergeant James said, "Go for him." And I went for him, and Sergeant James said, "Well, yes, because you need to grow some muscles. You need to grow some muscles." And the Monday morning, he was in the ring with us, with Archie Moore. At the end of the week, Archie Moore was so impressed with Kevin that he almost was turning his back on us. 2 weeks Archie Moore trained him for it, and Archie said to me, "Al, you have to now take charge of him, because Archie Moore's contract was not being renewed. He was Muslim. They found out Archie Moore's a black Muslim, and black in those days, you know, that's not the way to go. So his contract was not renewed. However, shortly after that, I found that KK also played cricket, had a straight bat. He was coached, and he absorbed the coaching. KK was a good swimmer. KK went down by the pool. KK don't dive off in the pool. KK dive off into the open sea. The band, we had a cadet band. KK was happy to see the band. He tried the bugle, didn't like the bugle, was very good at the flute, but what we wanted was a tenor drum. So most of the time he played the tenor drum, not the flute, but although he was good on the flute. We had a weekend Saturday morning, 6 mile run every morning in order to keep us fit. KK was there with me. We had debates, and somebody mentioned a while ago, KK is a deceiving man when it comes to knowledge, because he doesn't talk a lot. But KK had his little book. KK knew much about Martin Luther King, Che Guevara, Farrakhan, all those things. He knew more about those guys than I knew at that time. And in the debate, he was a resource person to the extent of where one morning they were having inspection of barracks, and the officer asked Corporal, what's his name? Blake. So what about this little man, Corporal Blake? Him, sir, black power, sir. Black power, him a black power. Ku Klux Klan, sir, KKK, Ku Klux Klan. So the soup scratched his head and said, how can you combine that black power and Ku Klux Klan in one man? Anyhow, I left, was transferred to Falmouth, and spent some months down here. Then H. Biggs, Henry Biggs, my class captain, came and joined me. Then KK came and joined me. Then a fellow by the name of, I can't remember his name. But all four of us, we were like birds of a feather, we flocked together. So we were at club meetings together. If they needed anybody to address 4-H clubs or so on, we were always there together. And anywhere you see one, you always see us. Until one day, this tall, dark, beautiful girl crossed the screen, and KK sort of was amazed and looked at this girl, and then he said, hello. And the girl turned and said, hi. And says, may I have a word with you? And she said, and then KK said, said to us, soon come here, sir. He never came back. Lived happily ever after. To the extent of where, when I talk with Henry Biggs, former superintendent Henry Biggs, and I talk with him every day, including this morning, Biggs always say, yeah, man, what's the name of KK's wife again? I say, Pauline. He say, yes, man, Pauline, man. Pauline. Pauline, man. I said, so why you keep saying Pauline? He said, Pauline, because she take away KK from we. I said, no, man, I'm making so and so. She said, yes, she take away KK from we. And I say, okay, she take away from KK from we, and almost turn him in a commissioner of police. He said, what you say? I said, nothing. But Pauline now, she was an avid member of the church. I always keep in touch. And for years, she has been texting me a Bible verse per morning and texting me her own thoughts about religion and so on. But then my eyes got worse and I had to ask her, please don't text me anything more. If you have a Bible verse, could you read it for me? If you have a thought, could you read it and record it for me? And she began to do that. Then she began to text these, and then if I my eyes got so bad, I couldn't play dominoes or anything, so I used my spare time and I learned the keyboard. So if I have a song or so on that I play at weddings, I play at church functions and funerals and so on. If I have a song that somebody requests and I don't know the air of it, I generally ask Pauline, do you know it? And she sings it for me, or she finds it and sends to me. So I explained that to Biggs. I said, this is what Pauline is doing for me. And Biggs said to me, say, Gally, you see where KK's strength come from, do? I say, yes, I. And she continues to, even now, she continues, in the midst of all that is happening, she continues to text these things to me. But she has all, when I call KK, and I do often call him often, she is always there to hand him the phone. When I call, it's not like she's in the kitchen or somewhere in the room or somewhere. She's always right beside him to hand him the phone. So I was impressed. So I said to Henry Biggs, I said, Biggs, boy, it looked like KK and Pauline live in our one room. He said, why you say that? I said, because when I call, she is not in the next room, not in the living room. She's within arm's length to hand him the phone. And Big says to me, yes, that looked like one room for you. So I said to Biggs, I said, Biggs, I need, KK has asked me to come and spend a weekend with him, KK and Pauline, and I have to go. It's difficult, but I'm waiting on one of my children to come from abroad. You know, when your children come from abroad, they rent cars and they have not all to do with it. So I wanted them to take me down and come back for me the next day or so on. But none of them came with such time. And so Biggs keep on insisting, Gally, you have to go, man. You have to go and spend some time. You have to go. I said, but how you mean I have to go and spend some time? And you say that they live in a one room. He said, I know me, sister, you. I said, no. I said, nobody not hear what this Jackie said. They hear what JP and superintendent said. That is evidence. And I would love to congratulate Pauline. You have always I heard somebody mention it and I had to applaud because that person knows what he's saying. She's always there for him. I mean, it's like a Bible story. It's like Job. It's like Naomi and what's the name of the other? Ruth and Naomi. That's a faithfulness. It's like a Bible story. And I really want to congratulate you. I didn't know that that was possible outside of the Bible. And the folks from Hillside, I have been there. I've actually crossed the fording at Seaford, gone to Hillside, I've walked to the house where KK was born, I've walked to the house where Hibbert, another policeman, was born, and I want to say hi and congratulations to you folks, the relatives and the friends who have journeyed from St. Thomas, because it's a place that I like, and you almost gave us a commissioner of police. I want you to congratulate yourself and applaud yourselves. I just want to end almost contradicting what I said before. KK, he was more than power in the left. He was more than power in the right. He was bright, erudite. To me, he is like a candle shining in the night. And I say he is like a candle shining in the night because he's not dead. He sleepeth. And when he wake, you can tell him what me say. I thank you very much.
May I invite those of us who are so able to stand please, and join me in the call to worship. We gather in the name of the Father.
The God who in love and who created us from love.
We gather in the name of the Son. We gather in the name of the Holy Spirit. Blessed are you, Lord our God, lover of souls. You uphold us in life and sustain us in death. To you be glory and praise forever. For the darkness of this age is passing away, as Christ, the bright and morning star, brings to his saints the light of life. As you give light to those in darkness who walk in the shadow of death, so remember in your kingdom your faithful servants, that death may be for them the gate to life and to unending fellowship with you, where with your saints you live and reign, one in perfect union of love, now and forever.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. We sing, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord.
Those are the sentiments of our heart, great and wonderful God. You are faithful, kind, loving. You are eternal, the God who walks with us through the curves and the turns of the journey of life, the one who meets us in our dark places, the one who holds us tenderly when we cry, the one who dances with us in times of joy. Great is your faithfulness, O loving God. You supply everything that we need for life and for godliness. In you we live, in you we move, in you we have our being. Great is your faithfulness. And as we meet like this today to celebrate the life of your servant Kelvin, we pray that through the songs that we sing, through the prayers that we offer, through your words spoken and broken, that we will sense the nearness of your spirit, that you will challenge our hearts to live for you even as we live among each other, that you will prepare us for the moment of death, but greater still, that resurrection day when we shall behold you face to face. So, Father, speak to us. We are listening. Hold us as you can. Walk with us. Steady us. Comfort us. And lift our eyes to behold your glory. You who are the King of glory. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come on earth, thy will be done on earth. And if your sin condemn your soul, you must pray. And if your sin condemn your soul, you must pray. Give us this day our daily bread, Lord, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive them that sin against us.
lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The kingdom, it is thine, the glory and the power. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed.
Good afternoon, everyone, or still morning. All protocols observed. Manners maketh a man. An admonition we've all heard from our parents from an early age. An adage that speaks to the very heart of our core values. Respect, kindness, honesty, decency, morality, right thinking, right action, responsibility, accountability, empathy, compassion, and civility. If manners made a man, Kelvin Kenyon Knight was a personification of manners. Born in the Blue Mountain Valley of St. Thomas, Kelvin was the oldest of 8 children to Amy Brown and Josephus Knight, otherwise called Mass Bob. Amy, a housewife, and Bob, a farmer, tailor, and a village lawyer, settled in Hillside St. Thomas to raise their 8 children. Kelvin inherited the quiet but observant disposition of his mother, Amy, a woman of few words, but quick-witted and sharp-tongued when needed, and the people skills of his father, Bob. As the eldest child, his father taught him responsibility at an early age. He was expected to assist on a farm, something he shared that he didn't mind doing, as when he went, he feasted on tomatoes, one of the crops his father planted. So much did he eat as a child that as an adult he hated tomatoes. He was expected to ensure that water was available for his mother to do what was needed, including cooking the dinner. We've heard the story of one evening my grandfather came home, the dinner was not ready. He asked why the dinner wasn't ready, and my grandmother told him that she had sent Kelvin for the water to prepare the dinner and he hadn't returned. His father promptly left in search of him. He had stopped to chat and play marbles with his friends, but had finally filled his bucket and was heading back. Seeing his father coming, he dropped the bucket and ran. My grandfather behind him, he climbed an aki tree to get away. In front of his friends and the community, he said Mass Bob climbed the aki tree and gave him the beating of his life just the same. An experience he never forgot, but one which set him straight. Kelvin was ambitious and family conscious. At the age of 17, he left his parents and sibling in Hillside and headed for Kingston for the police force. He had applied to the force, but because of his young age, he was placed in the cadet corps before becoming a part of the Jamaica Constabulary Force in 1966. He worked hard, cognizant of the responsibilities back home, and ensured that he helped his parents with his siblings. In February 1967, he was transferred for the first time to serve in Trelawney. Little did he know this would be the beginning of the rest of his life. During his transfer, he was mistakenly taken to another parish. However, when the error was found out, he was retrieved. Mom jokes that the Lord knew he had to come to Trelawney because he had her here waiting for him. As a young beat and foot officer, a part of his duty was going into the different communities to liaise with the community contacts. He was told by his superiors that in Rock District, the point person was one Charlotte Whitaker, Miss Lattie, the shopkeeper. He would visit her on a regular basis to discuss the happenings in Rock. He had no idea that he would eventually become a part of this woman's family. And Lattie told us that this handsome, polite young policeman would come and visit her, but every time he came around, she would tell him all was well, no one was giving any trouble. My father over the years laughed at how cautious Aunt Lattie had been to ensure that she did her civic duty, but at the same time, not get anyone in trouble with the police. In December 1967, a mutual friend, a policeman from Waiterbeet, now retired Superintendent Leonard Lawrence, unknowingly became Cupid, as he invited both Pauline Evans and his squaddy Kelvin Knight to his birthday party. The party was at his home in Waiterbeet, and both invitees made their way from Falmouth. Mom recalls that she was at the party with friends, and when everyone went to dance, it turned out they were the only two not dancing, and he eventually asked her to dance. She said that he later asked his friend about her, as he had recalled seeing her at the bus stop in Falmouth in a pink dress, not knowing she was headed to the same destination. My father's side of the story is that he met her at a party and recalled how pretty she was in her pink mini dress, stoosh and popping style on him, fully aware of how cute she was. So impactful was this pink dress, it has been preserved throughout their marriage and is still hanging in Mom's closet today. So precious was their meeting, Dwight was shown the exact spot where they met in Waitabit. After the party, Mom said he pursued her. He began visiting her home in Falmouth. Even if she was not home, he stayed and socialized with her family, endearing himself to her grandmother, Aunt Amelia Evans, and the rest of her family. He had already won the heart of her Aunt Charlotte in his professional capacity. Kelvin and Pauline fell in love and got married in December 1969. They made their home at 25 Princess Street in Falmouth before moving to Refuge and finally settling in the home they built together in Bounty Hall. 52 years later, their marriage has been an example of love, forgiveness, dedication, partnership, compassion, devotion, and peace. As children, we knew that the only one who could make our father late was Mom. He waited on no one else. We all knew Mom shouldn't reach the car before us or we would get left behind. Our brother Sean, who was constantly late, knew he had to keep a close eye on Mom to make sure she didn't get there before him, as there were many mornings he had to chase the car out to the streets, pants and socks in hand, as Mom had gotten to the car and our father immediately drove off. Whatever Mom gave him to eat, he ate. Whatever she gave him to wear, he wore, sometimes protesting, but more often than not, complying. He was a simple and humble person and often asked Mom if she wanted him to dress in tuxedo every day. Mom's welfare and happiness was his priority. He was the man of the house, but Mom had him like putty in her hands. Years ago, prior to him getting sick, Mom had to do surgery. For the entire time leading up to the surgery, he developed a hiccup. While Mom was in surgery, Steve, or Kelvin as some of you know him, decided to take him out to distract him. About an hour later, Steve called to say that he was at Andrew's hospital and they had our father on a drip and was deciding if they needed to keep him. We went into management mode. Whatever was going on, we would have to move him to UE2 as we couldn't manage them in two different hospitals. He was, however, released, and by the time they got back to UE, Mom was out of recovery and back in her room. As soon as he saw her and saw that she was okay, the hiccups stopped. He was so nervous and worried about her that he had made himself sick. Coming from the hospital on one occasion while he was sick, Steve went to lift him from the car. Needing his help, Steve kept saying, "Look at me, Super, focus on me," as he wanted him to put his hands around his neck while lifting him. After about three requests for him to focus on him, he promptly turned and admonished him, "I'm looking at my beautiful wife." She was his wife, the love of his life. He still wanted to hold her hand and still wanted her to sit with him. The beautiful young girl he fell in love with at that party was still beautiful to him until the day he passed away. The love they have for each other was evident in our home. Our parents have been an example of what love and dedication should be. They dedicated their lives to the Lord and to each other and became the yin to each other's yang. They have lived their vows and were perfectly matched. A union that has nurtured not just their children, but many within the church and community. While Kelvin pursued love, he dedicated himself to work. He loved the Jamaica Constabulary Force and was committed to his duty to country, community, and his fellow man. He was a police officer at heart, and the JCF meant everything to him. He took pride in discharging his duties and served his community with empathy and compassion. While serious or stern, as described by someone on Facebook, he was approachable and giving. My mother is a giver, her generosity quietly facilitated by our father. We have heard the stories of the people he has helped over the years. One such story is of an incident when he was stationed in Montego Bay. The police had carried out an operation and several persons had been detained. He entered the guard room and saw persons sitting waiting to be processed. He went through the group, checking what they were being held for. Those he thought could go, he sent away. Others got processed. Getting ready to leave work, he saw one woman who he had told a few hours earlier that she could leave. Surprised to see her, he asked her what she was still doing there. Crying, she told him that she had borrowed $1,000 from her neighbor to buy the junker beads to make the jewelry to sell. She expected to return the borrowed funds from her sale in addition to making a little money. Her misfortune with the police and having the goods confiscated had left her in a quandary. Not only did he give her the funds to repay her neighbor, but gave her money to help herself. He went a step further and asked Mom, who at the time was a villa manager at Triol in Hanover, if she could find a job for her. An interaction that changed the trajectory of this lady's life, who is now living in the US, only because she met a man who empathized and had compassion. He was not only compassionate, but he was also a courageous officer. I recall a Sunday being taken back to Westwood, and he received a call that a machete-wielding man of unsound mind had entered this very church and had attacked some of its members. Some members were holed up in the vestry, fearful for their lives. He deposited Mom and I at Miss Tell, one of the members who was holed up in the vestry, and came to the assistance of the church. By recount of what transpired, he tried to lure the man out of the church, cognizant of the sacredness of the space, the well-being of those around, and even the man who was known to the police. He tried to talk him down and coax him from the church. However, when the man lunged at him, he had to discharge his weapon, something he regretted having to do, even though he himself had been hurt. He did, however, aim to avoid killing the man in the church. He was firm, a disciplinarian, principled, and believed in the gospel, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God. He lived his life and carried out his work under this banner. As children, we too knew what was expected of us. His guidance took us down the same path. On one fateful occasion, when Kelvin Jr. had the misfortune to run into the back of a police squad car in Kingston. He called his father. Our father asked one question: do you have insurance? Getting the response in the affirmative, he said, you go fix the government vehicle and give it back to them within this week. You can go claim on the insurance to fix your car. Understanding the consequences of a vehicle being out of commission while awaiting the insurance claim, he wanted to ensure that neither the police nor the community at large would be left handicapped by this incident. Our father was a paradox. He was a man of few words, but also a man of many words. An avid reader, sharp-tongued, and quick-witted, much like his mother. He read the Gleaner daily and did so with a dictionary beside him. He took courses in public speaking and journalism to augment his passion for words. While his illness ravaged his body, his mind, when the toxins allowed, was as sharp as a tack. When we called, sometimes he wouldn't get on the phone, but we knew he was listening to every word of the conversation. And there were times out of the blue we'd hear him chime up, "It's were hope, not was," or some other grammatical correction to something he heard Mom say. Mom had to be on her grammatical P's and Q's. Mom was a talker, and he often teased her about her constant talking. Sylvan, their driver, shared that on one trip to dialysis, after complaining that she was talking too much, Mom went silent. Not hearing her for a while, he called out, "Hope, Hope," thinking he wanted something. She answered, "Yes, dear." He goes, "Oh, me no hear you. Me think you drop out of the van." Not many knew that my dad was colorblind. As children, we accidentally discovered this because he would send us to fetch a blue towel on the line, and we would be outside spinning as no blue towel was on the line. He would angrily point, "Not the blue towel that," and we say, "No, Mr. Knight, this is green." So yes, we called our dad Mr. Knight. As growing up, we heard everyone refer to him as Sir Knight. And we called our mom Aunt Hope, as that is what we heard. Our mom put a stop to Aunt Hope and told us it's Mom. Our father corrected us, but didn't say it's Dad. He told us it's Mr. Knight. As we grew older, we called him the other names used by the wider community: Corpy, Sarge, Spec, Super, and for me, he was Super D. He was a humble servant of the people. No matter what rank he was, he answered to whatever he was called. Corporal Knight, Constable Knight, Sergeant Knight, Inspector Knight, SSP Knight, it didn't matter. He responded to them all. The name used would make him know how long that person had known him. Being the children of this man, we all knew that a high standard was expected and even demanded of us. Education was important, and he ensured that we were all pushed to achieve. Once he received our book lists, the books were purchased, and during the summer holidays, we had to read the literature books before school started. He made no demands for us to be doctors or lawyers, but we were expected to be the best that we could. As children, we would not take home anything that did not belong to us. "Go pick up a book" has been heard by all of us. Steve recalls the trauma of learning his timetables. Every evening, our dad would insist that he learn the tables and he would have to recite it to him. Our books and bags were reviewed consistently. Nervously, I'm now remembering that time in high school when, unknown to me, a note was placed in one of my books. During his routine check of schoolwork, my father discovered the love note. To this day, I have no knowledge of what was on the note, but man, was that a long night. He was a present father. He was involved in all our lives. He celebrated our achievements, and he shared in our hurt. He was our protector and our provider. Our father was a policeman outside our gates. However, once he entered our home, he became our dad. Don't get me wrong, we all knew he was a police officer, and the signs of that was around us. We all had our turn at stringing up his uniform or burnishing the police boots. The white noise of the radio, especially in the mornings as the stations did their roll call. We would, however, witness the shift between roles, as very often people came to him at home and the police officer would go out to them, but our father re-entered the house. Our father didn't suffer fools gladly. He especially expected us, as his children, to be alert and move with wisdom. I learned that at the staging of Hague Agricultural Show. Mom had a stall where she was showcasing her interior design skills, including throw pillows, which she had on sale. Long and short, I was bamboozled by a young man who successfully robbed me without me realizing. The act was observed and caught by others who quickly summoned my father. He successfully apprehended the culprit and handed him over to the police, not before the would-be thief offered up the cash he had taken. You'd think this story ends here. All's well that ends well. Not for me. He came back to me, and I was duly admonished for being gullible and unobservant enough for something like that to have happened to me. For Steve, the lesson came earlier, as one day, despite multiple cautions from Denise to stop playing with a box of matches, he lit one of the matches and replaced it in the box. The box exploded in his face. Hearing the ensuing cowballing, our father ran from the shower to investigate what was happening. When Denise told him what had happened, he gave Steve the beating of his life, but also ensured that he was taken care of. Steve, do you still play with matches? Lesson learned. His love for us as children overflowed to his grandchildren, in whom he took special interest. He loved them all, and they loved him. Braille, the youngest, showered him with love, whether or not he wanted it. Having a wife and family was a serious undertaking. He was ambitious and hardworking. Not many knew Kelvin the farmer. He worked hard so he could take care of his family, at one time supplementing his JCF income by planting pumpkin in Fountable. He worked the fields after finishing his police duties. Mom recalls accompanying him one day and was brought to tears when she saw how hard he had to work, strapping the blower on his back and walking the 5 acres back and forth to spray the pumpkin plants. He sold truckloads of these pumpkins to the AMC. Our father was an avid cricket fan, a West Indies fan through and through, in good times and bad. He loved music and tried his hand at songwriting, one of which he had sung and recorded in California. Unknown to many, he also did a short stint as a member of the JCF band, playing the drum, the flute, and the bugle. He loved music and loved to dance. Many a police balls have been attended. It is said it takes a village, and it did take a village for our family. Our family thanks everyone for the outpouring of love and support. We know our father was loved and respected, but in death it has been energized. Today we want to express our thanks to the many who assisted, prayed, and stayed in touch while he was here. We thank the staff of Latham Dialysis and Zurich Dialysis for their support and care of our dad over the years. To Winsome, I know she's here somewhere, from Latham in Kingston, Miss Bowen and Mario from Zurich, thank you for the personal care you gave to our dad. Thanks to the many doctors and nurses over the years who took care of him, to Dr. Michael Godfrey and Dr. Patrick Harris for their patience with this gentleness in handling this patient. Dr. Harris, thank you for having mom's back over the years. We have personally witnessed and appreciate your defense of the person and caregiver that she was. Our father was a fighter and fought long and hard against this disease, not complaining. We thank the drivers who took care of him during the many hospital and dialysis runs. Ken, Sylvan, and Louis. Sylvan, thank you. Words cannot express our thanks. Your love and care for our father, who you affectionately called Capo or Poppins, was evident even to strangers who witnessed how you handled him. To our aunts and uncles and extended family, our father was not a talker and very often would not get on the phone, but be assured that he knew you called and very often heard every word exchanged between yourself and mom. To my uncle and siblings, your father said he could not ask for better children. You can rest assured that he loved us and knew that he was loved. I will let him tell you in his own words later today. Steve and Dwight, we have had many long nights, many tears, many frustrations with the hospitals, and have done miles of walks along hospital corridors. But I know you guys will do it all over. To my ride or die Steve, thanks for the poignant moments when, as we traveled together, heavy from our sadness or stress, without asking or telling, you always read the room and found a way for us to just breathe. Patrice, it's been a long, hard road. You have held the front line, and you stood at his bedside as he made his transition. We know it hasn't been easy. Thank you. David, as his bonus son, you couldn't have given more of yourself. Thank you. Mr. Bernard, please stand. To Mr. Bernard, or Bertram, as our father affectionately called him, we owe you a wealth of gratitude. You are God-sent and became our father's best friend and companion in his last days. This man's hands were the last to hold my father before he took his last breath. Thank you. Last, but certainly not least, Mom, we know how much we owe you, as you have cared and loved him like no one else could. We know that he was here this long only because you fought. He fought because he saw that you were not ready. Our father loved you. We saw him making preparations to ensure you would be okay before he left this earth. You both built a partnership that was solid and strong. You were the yin to each other's yang and had your own song and dance, which sometimes as kids we didn't understand, but we knew our places. We saw the love. Your husband was charming, loving, devoted. He took his vows seriously and even in sickness remained a husband and caregiver in his own way. None of us can imagine or say we know what you feel today. But as your family and community, we stand with you, extending our love and continued support as you try to come to terms with this new reality. Romans 12:10 charges, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves, you have lived this flawlessly. Mark 5 tells the story of the woman with the issue of blood who touched the hem of Jesus' garment. To that woman he said, "Go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole." We know you have been clinging to Jesus' garment, and I'm going to ask the ministers who are here if you could just stand and stretch your hands to Mom as we just sing and encourage her.
Mom, you've come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He never fails.
Leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. You have lived your vows, staying committed and faithful in sickness and in health. From that fateful night in 1967 when you met, to the last moments as he transitioned from this earth, you held his hands in love. Isaiah 57 verse 2 says, "Those who walked uprightly enter into peace, they find rest as they lie in death." Scripture teaches us that to everything there is a season, a time to be born and a time to die. My sister Denise says the date of our birth and death are not what's important, but the dash between the dates which represents our lives. To us, he was larger than life, infallible. His sickness was a reality check for us. We grieve today because we loved. We have lost one of the main veins of our ecosystem, but we stand proud because he was a God-fearing man, a loving and devoted husband, a reliable and nurturing father, a doting grandfather, a caring brother, a cherished uncle, a beloved friend, and a proud and dedicated, courageous public servant. Our tears today are not out of sadness, for the life lived we know was one well lived. As a man of God and our brother in Christ, those of us in the body of Christ know that there is hope in death, as death is the beginning of our reward. So we will meet again. In May of this year, turning 75, he said he wanted a big party and we should invite everyone. This request was outside his nature. Logistics didn't allow it, and we were not able to pull off the party, but perhaps it was his signaling of what his last hurrah should be. Your presence here today have fulfilled his wishes. So, in my father's voice, on behalf of my wife and I, thank you for coming. Rest in peace, Super.
Move in remembrance. Right this time, we'll have the musical selection by Adrian Dell, Nephew, followed by the offertory prayer, which will be done by
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven answering. Methought the voice of angels from heaven answering. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, up your gates and sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. Then methought my dream was changed, the streets no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the moon was cold and chill. As the shadow of the cross arose upon the lonely hill, as the shadow of the cross arose upon the lonely hill. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, hark how the angels sing, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna to your King. And once again the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on the street, the gates are opened wide. No need of moon or stars by night, or sun to shine by day. It was the new generation.
We are about to receive a special offering. And as the ushers prepare themselves, I invite us to take a posture of prayer as we give thanks for that which we're about to receive. Let us pray. Sovereign God, we give you thanks for every opportunity to give to you. But every time we think about giving to you and to your work, we cannot help but to ask ourselves, who are we to give to you when all that we have and all that we are is yours? But then we comfort ourselves in knowing that we give as a sign of us giving of ourselves to you. And so as we give today, God, in this worship experience, we pray that you will allow us to do so freely. And let it be, Lord, that your blessing will be upon all of us and upon that which is given to your work. We pray that it will multiply. We pray, O God, that like the loaves and two fishes, it will multiply so that we can continue your work, your mission that you have called us to. Into your hands we place ourselves. Into your hands we place the offering at this time. Through Jesus Christ, O Lord, we pray. And together we say, amen and amen. And while the offering is being received, we're going to be listening to a musical selection from our saxophonist, Mr. Seymour Heron.
I'm not on the program, I'm not coming to take over. Just before the saxophonist plays, Mom requested this song of Nicholas. And since Nicholas could not sing it, I've asked Mr. Heron to do it for you.
Thank you. so good to be in a familiar place. First, let me give thanks to Almighty God for allowing me to be here today. Let me also acknowledge the distinguished members of the clergy present this morning. To the family and friends of Senior Superintendent Knight, we all mourn his departure from us. Though Senior Superintendent Knight is physically gone, his spirit will live in our hearts forever. To his dear and loving wife, caregiver and friend, my sister and mother, Pastor Pauline Knight, also known to many of us as Hope, let me say that indeed you are among the few giants of women. As a couple, you have demonstrated the true meaning of love. 50 years ago in this church, you and your dear friend, KK Knight, joined in holy matrimony. Included in the vow you both made are the words, "For better or worse, till death do us part." Those words gave meaning to the often unused term, soulmates. After all those years, it is obvious that not even death can separate the two of you. Considering that the average marriage today lasts 10 years or less, if there was a Grammy or Oscar award for marriage, you would have earned many awards. There is this popular expression, behind every successful man, there is a woman. Indeed, you are that woman. Senior Superintendent Knight was more than a successful man. He was a great man, a dedicated and committed husband. He was part of the rock on which you both built your lives. Thank you for bringing Mr. Knight into my life. I consider him a father. In the program, I am listed as one of his sons. I know I have to try and explain this to you, and rightly so. In the early years, I always referred to my sister's husband as Mr. Knight, not Kelvin. Over the years, his hard work and dedication to excellence has resulted in his title Senior Superintendent KK Knight, a title he earned. Let it be known that Senior Superintendent Knight had been part of my life for years. I was here when he said, "I do," to my sister, mother. He was present at my main events of life, some of my main events. He was at my high school graduation that took place in this same church. He was at my graduation at Howard University in Washington, D.C. in 1987 when I received my doctoral degree. The following year, he was at my wedding in Philadelphia. You will meet my lovely wife later. Senior Superintendent Knight was also here in this church when I was a guest speaker at the 2005 graduation ceremony for William Knibb Memorial High School, my high school. At his 50th wedding anniversary, Senior Superintendent Knight stated that he considered me as his son, one of his sons, without using DNA or the Maury show. He is my father. I consider KK Knight as the behind-the-scenes father who always wanted to bring out the best in us. So gentlemen, now you know that you don't have to be a sperm donor to be a father. Proverbs 23:18 states, "There is surely a future hope for you, and your hope will not be cut off." Let us celebrate Senior Superintendent Knight's life with a theme of hope. Senior Superintendent Knight always referred to his wife as Hope. Even during the years of sickness, he had hope. Judging by his action, it seems as if he was more concerned about what was going to happen to Hope rather than what is happening to himself. His unselfish nature is one of the reasons why Senior Superintendent Knight was loved by his wife, family, and friends. Senior Superintendent Knight was highly respected by his peers. In addition, he was admired and adored by many in the community he stationed. In a real sense, one of the ideas of Hope is to be able to see light despite being in the darkness. Somewhere I read that the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. That is the light of hope and dream that Senior Superintendent Knight wanted. Senior Superintendent Knight, you have heard, came from a humble background. One of 8 siblings from the parish of St. Thomas. His hope was to be all that he can ever be, a productive member of society, a decent law-abiding citizen, a law enforcer, and a man of God. Senior Superintendent Knight accomplished all those expectations. You heard that at the age of 17, young KK Knight wanted to join the Jamaica Constabulary Force. When he applied, I said he was denied entry because of his age. He was a bit disappointed. So consequently, they said he joined the police cadet. The Reverend Dr. King once said, "We must accept finite disappointment, but never lose infinite hope." 4 years later, young KK Knight's fantasy became a reality when he was accepted in the Jamaica Constabulary Force, and the rest is history. This is the reason why we now refer to KK Knight, that sharp, well-dressed, soft-spoken man, a Senior Superintendent KK Knight, a title he hoped for and again a title he earned. This is a clear demonstration that in a desire for accomplishment and success, if your mind can conceive it and deep in your heart you believe it, surely you can achieve it. KK Knight came through the various ranks of the Jamaica Constabulary Force to become Senior Superintendent, not because of luck, but by making the necessary preparation. He always used the opportunity to take the necessary educational courses to get himself to the next level. During his career as a law enforcer, KK Knight, Senior Superintendent Knight, earned 9 commendations, we heard that, and many other awards, including the Medal of Honor for Meritorious Service from the Governor General. In recent years, we have witnessed the degeneration of law enforcement, not just nationally, but internationally. Years gone by, left, right, was the exhibition of style and grace by police officers. The feet would be moving, the hands would be moving, left, right. In today's world, the story is told. I'm not saying it's true, but officers, don't get upset with me. What I heard is that a mere traffic violation can be translated into left or right. Oh, the left means something else, the right, the ticket. As a result of the unprofessional behavior of a few officers, many of our fine, decent, and honest police officers are being blamed for the corrupt behavior of a few. I am sure that Senior Superintendent Knight would not mind me using the local expression that was included in a song by a person who he admired, Robert Nesta Marley, Bob Marley. "Who the cap fits, let them wear it." For the many law enforcement officers present here today, I am sorry. But I'm sorry to use this example, but we have to use every means necessary with the help of concerned citizens to bring back respectability, decency, and trust to law enforcement profession. This is the hope that Senior Superintendent Knight would have wanted. In spite of the numerous awards and recognition earned by Senior Superintendent Knight during his career, there is a letter written on his behalf that he kept for years. This document summarizes the sentiments of many, if not all, individuals who have interacted with Senior Superintendent Knight and how they feel about it. And it reads, I have known Senior Superintendent at the time, KK Knight, for over 30 years. During this time, he has exhibited and maintained the highest discipline, moral standards. He is honest in his dealing, hardworking, trustworthy, and associates himself with people with good repute. His pleasant and caring attitude have won the love of a wide cross-section of people, especially in his community. Over the years I've known him, I have no knowledge of him being involved in any illicit activities. Based on the above, I unhesitatingly recommend him. I am sure that he will give satisfaction, thus living up to your expectation of him. End of quote. Integrity, dignity, honesty, determination, excellence, and self-respect are some of the qualities that describe the life of Senior Superintendent Knight. Hope for a better tomorrow, where our young people will grow up to be productive members of society, law enforcers, scientists, engineers, doctors, lawyers, medical professionals, essential workers, rather than scammers, line jumpers, and phone bangers. There are still many caring people in this world, and I witnessed the attention given to Senior Superintendent Knight by his caregiver during his challenging time. Caregivers that my niece mentioned, such as Bernard, his right hand, Sylvan, his driver, his daughter Patrice, and the many other family members. I must also mention the medical professionals, including Dr. Harris. His dedication in assisting, or their dedication in assisting Superintendent Knight during this challenging time, give us hope that there are still more good people in this world than bad. Senior Superintendent Knight was not a perfect servant. As a police officer, he was a public servant. Most importantly, he was a servant of God. Senior Superintendent Knight was recognized by the Gospel Tabernacle Deliverance Center of Canaan for his 25 years of exemplary, unparalleled, and unwavering service in ministry, church, and the community. He was truly a servant of God. To the young people present here today, use the life of Senior Superintendent Knight as an example. Senior Superintendent Knight's life can be beautifully summed up by some of the words of a poem by an American poet, Douglas Mallock. If you can't be a pine on the top of the hill, be a shrub in the valley, but be the best little shrub by the side of the rail. Be a bush if you can't be a tree. If you can't be a highway, be a trail. If you can't be the sun, be a star. It isn't by size that you win or you fail. Be the best of whatever you are. While juggling his professional career and family responsibility, Senior Superintendent Knight find time to relax. He was a big-time farmer. He planted yam, banana, and other provisions necessary to feed his family and friends. However, you could not get him to plant the weed. No weed, even when it was legalized. You know why? It was not part of the get-rich scheme. Senior Superintendent Knight was a big cricket fan. Sometimes while watching a game, Senior Superintendent Knight behaved as if he was the captain or the umpire of the game, even though he's watching it on TV. I am sure that he was disappointed with the performance of the current West Indies team in the World Cup, because they didn't go there. But without giving up hope, his spirit will see them rise again. For some reason, as mentioned, Senior Superintendent Knight was fascinated with the sport of boxing. He was a big fan of the great Muhammad Ali, George Foreman, Joe Frazier. Combining the qualities of all three men, the result is hard work, dedication, determination. Senior Superintendent Knight demonstrated all those qualities. He was also an admirer of our youth club, Conquerors Club. My dear friend and brother, the late Bulbul, a former president of the club, and also MP of this area and senior superintendent Knight will always be in discussion about national and international affairs. Keep in mind that senior superintendent Knight was apolitical and Bulbul was extremely political. I can just imagine what the confusion will be when they meet again. If the COVID pandemic has taught us anything, is that we as a society is very vulnerable. Many of us have lost loved ones, relatives and friends. We are here today, gone tomorrow. We can lease a house, we can lease an apartment, but there is no lease on life. So I say to the members of the family, biological and non-biological siblings, friends, and associates of senior superintendent Knight, whatsoever our differences, we must forgive each other, redeem each other, regroup, and move on. Relatively speaking, life is short. According to social media, senior superintendent Knight is described as an icon in this society. An honor so fitted for him. Coming from his humble background, limited resources, but with self-determination and hope, senior superintendent Knight has shown us that even though you were born in the slum, does not mean that the slum is born in you, a term made popular by Jesse Jackson. There is little that one can say that will comfort our family and friends of senior superintendent Knight in this time of bereavement. Nevertheless, we can only hope that when all is said and done, we hope and pray that the Almighty God may grant senior superintendent Knight eternal rest. Finally, may the soul of senior superintendent Knight, a husband, a father, a grandfather, a brother, an uncle, and a friend, rest in eternal peace. Thank you for listening.
Good afternoon to everyone. Certainly, we all have come to celebrate a life well lived, one who has not given us an inheritance, but has left us a legacy. What a great family. I invite you to, in respect and honor, to a knight in shining armor, to stand with me as the family remains seated as I offer a word of prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we come to you in thankfulness because you loan to this world an asset that cannot be replaced. And in your own wisdom, you have promoted him as we celebrate his life today. We come because we knew when you walked the face of this earth, you as God demonstrated how caring you were to every family in your path that suffered loss. You gave a word of encouragement to the woman taking her son down the dusty roads of Nain. While death was going down the hill, life was coming up the hill. You stopped the procession and you gave life. To Mary and Martha, you encouraged their hearts when you told them, I am the resurrection and the life. To the soldier who served his country, you walked into his bedroom and you said to his daughter, Talitha Kumi, you brought her back to life. Now you are speaking to our hearts that you are still the resurrection and the life. And indeed, Kevin will be brought back to life in the day of the resurrection. But we need you today to comfort the hearts of the bereaved. We ask you, as you did before you left earth, you made a promise, let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. So we pray that your Holy Spirit will convey this promise to this family today, that their hearts will not be troubled about his past, because certainly he did well for the time you gave him on this earth. That his life and their lives will not be troubled about his present situation, because this is just getting him ready for the transition. That they will never be worried about his future, because you have prepared and reserved a place in heaven for everyone who trusts you and everyone who serves you. So we pray in a very special way for this family. God, remember Pauline. Remember the children, Albert, Denise, Dwight, Kelvin Jr., Michelle and Patrice. Remember his own siblings and everyone who falls in the category of family. Strengthen our hearts today. Go with us with a thought so cemented that even though we pass through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. Protect this family. Continue to provide for this family. And continue to give them the assurance that all is not lost, because this is heaven's gain. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good afternoon. The Old Testament lesson comes to us from Ezekiel chapter 34, 11 through 16. For thus saith the Lord God, behold, I, even I, will both search my sheep and seek them out. As a shepherd seeketh out his flock in the day, that he is among his sheep that are scattered, so will I seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all places where they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. And I will bring them out from the people and gather them from the countries and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in a good pasture, and upon the high mountains of Israel shall their fold be. There shall they lie in a good fold, and in a fat pasture shall they feed upon the mountains of Israel. I will feed my flock, and I will cause them to lie down, saith the Lord God. I will seek that which was lost, and bring again that which was driven away, and will bind up that which was broken, and will strengthen that which was sick. But I will destroy the fat and the strong, and I will feed them with judgment. Here ends the reading of the Holy Word.
Good afternoon, church. All protocols observed. The New Testament lesson comes to us from St. John 11, 21 to 27. Reading from the New International Version. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world. Here endeth the reading of God's holy word.
Good afternoon, all. All protocols observed. Reading from the epistle. Reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verses 1 to 7. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride anointed for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, and for the former things have passed away. And he sat down upon the throne and said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto them, write, for these words are true and faithful. And he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, and the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. The word of the Lord.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Western region of the Deliverance Evangelistic Association, we want to take this opportunity to say to the Knights family, earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Be comforted in that reality that Deacon Knight is gone to be with the Lord, and we will meet him again. We'll do this song, Beulah Land. That was one of his favorite songs. I'm kind of homesick for a city to which I have never been before. No sad goodbyes will there be spoken, for time won't matter can cross the rivers. There's just a few more, a few more days to labor, and then I'll take my heavenly flight. I'm looking across that river. For us to labor, and then we'll all take, we'll take that heavenly flight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Church of God, say amen. And the Church of God, say amen one more time. Good afternoon, my brothers and sisters. It's not usual for a Baptist preacher to stand in a pulpit 3 hours after worship has begun. That spells danger. But I promise you that I will not keep you here unduly. Can I just use the opportunity to recognize the pastoral team that is here and to say that I never envisioned, even after 23 years of being a pastor, that my name would be on anything that one of the stalwarts of the ministry and the faith, his name is mentioned. And I'm quite sure if you see that I am a little nervous, it is because Bishop Harold Blair is in the house. And Bishop Blair, we grew up with you, grew up listening to you. And what a great man of God he has been. And I must recognize that. But I also want just quickly to say, I am not necessarily the best person to have been or the most qualified to stand here on this occasion. But nonetheless, I feel like Jesus. And I feel like the word of God that says, other sheep I have that are not of this fold. And having been pastor of this circuit between the years 2007 to 2020, other sheep I have that were not of this fold. And it happens that KKK was one such sheep. He would normally tease me each time I preach, for like my friend Wayne in the back, I will always say, come with me, church. And I would not miss today without asking you to come with me, church. Amen, church. Now I am going to ask you to touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, come on, neighbor, I'm happy you are sitting beside me. One more time, neighbor, come on, I'm happy you're sitting beside me. Sir Treasure, I notice you are here. Sir Treasure, I notice you are here. I will speak to the minister about you not being at school today. Can I ask you to bear with me for another 15 or so minutes? And I share with you from half of a verse and half of another verse. Nehemiah chapter number 5. Nehemiah chapter number 5. Verse number 15C and 16A. 15C says, but I did not do so because of the fear of God. And in verse 16, indeed, I devoted myself to the work on the wall. One more time. I did not do so because of the fear of the Lord. Instead, I devoted myself to the work on the wall. Can we pray? Father, we thank you for your word. And even now we pray that the words of my feeble mouth and the meditation of our hearts be accepted in your sight. O God, for you are our strength, and only you can redeem us. And the church of God say, amen. And the church say, amen. My brothers and sisters, each time we are forced to grapple with the book of Nehemiah, we must grapple, and we continue to grapple with his diligence in rebuilding the walls. Today, I would not want to waste your time in sharing with you what you have already known. No, but we are dealing with an aspect of his journey that is hardly elevated.
What's the context and what's happening in the passage? Read chapter number 5 when you get a chance, and you are going to realize that all kinds of things were happening. Being the leader, his own folks came back to him with a complaint. What was the complaint? Our own people are overcharging us. Our own people are taking more from us. Our own people are treating us as second-class citizens. Let me go again because this church has gone quiet on me. Our own people are treating us badly. And he called the people together and said to them, I have received the complaint, and I am now mandating you to treat the people right. Give them back their lands. Preach, pastor. Give them back their houses. Give them back what they have borrowed from you, and stop stretching and stressing the people. You see, my brothers and sisters, had it been a Sunday morning, we would have had to park here long enough to say that there are those who could easily fit within the context of this passage, for they are feeling the burden of their own brothers and sisters. That's another thing for another time. But the truth is, friends, it is easy for us to confront and to deal with strangers, but it is more difficult for us to confront and to deal with our own people. Preach now, pastor. It is not only difficult to confront our own people, it is more difficult to confront those who are in our inner circle. One more time. It is even more difficult to deal and to confront those who are in our own churches. Back up with me, somebody, and let's see what Nehemiah said. He declared that I have noticed what has been happening, but I did not do so, he said. Since I have been appointed, I did not partake, nor did I participate in the ways that they have done it. I have done things differently because I have feared the Lord. Back up with. All right, now. No, notice the passage, church, that Nehemiah said, ever since I have been appointed, I have feared the Lord. Note then, friends, he is making the observation that his role was not given to him by the king, nor was it given to him by the people. His role was given to him first and foremost by the living God. And that's why he used the word appointed and not selected. He said, since I have been appointed, which means since I have been ordained, since I have been consecrated, since I have been set apart to holy service, I could not do what the others are doing because I fear the Lord. Can I beg somebody then, park here long enough with me, because what is it that would keep somebody in the Jamaica Constabulary Force all these years yet walked with his head high? What would have kept a man in the Constabulary Force all these years and retired with all of us still singing his praises? He understood one thing, that he was not selected by the Governor General, nor was he sent by the Prime Minister, nor was he selected by the Commissioner of Police, but he was appointed appointed by the living God. He was anointed and appointed by God. I wish I had five persons in the church who could agree with me that where I am is not because of my education. It's not because of my standing or my status. I am where I am because I have been appointed and anointed by God. If you see me smiling, it is not because I have anything good to say, but because a man named Jesus laid his hand upon my life and sent me on my way rejoicing. And so I stand here like Nehemiah. I am standing here as an appointed servant of the Most High God. Watch then with me, and I close you out in 5 minutes. Can I do that, church? Can I do that, church? He said, because I was appointed by God, I couldn't do what the others were doing. Hold these three things. One, he guarded his call. Come on, church. He guarded his call. What do you mean by that, church? He said, I guarded my call because I fear the Lord. Mm-hmm. One more time. Is the chaplain saying I must go on? He guarded his call. Why? Because he said, I fear the Lord. You know what that means for us, church? That the reason no one is hunting us down, the reason some of us are not behind bars, the reason we have not been dragged in front of the courts, the reason some of us have not told you a piece of our mind, the reason why some of us are still where we are because we have a call to guard, and we guard that because of the fear of God. Hold this with me quickly, church, because anybody who fears God knows that the fear of the Lord restrains you. It is the fear of God that causes resistance in you, and it is the fear of God that reinforces you where you are. Can I help somebody then? And that's why Indicom could not have knocked at his door, because he feared God. Come on, church of God. And that's why his name was not in any scandal, because he feared God. Do I have two persons yet who will agree with me that when you fear God, it provides the restraint? When you fear God, it provides the resistance. And when you fear God, it provides the reinforcement. Oh, I wish I had a church that would agree with me that I am here this hour because I still fear God. I have learned how to lean and depend on Jesus. I've found out if I fear him, he will be my restraint. He will be my resistance. He will be my reinforcement. Do I have somebody yet who will say, I know in whom I have believed, and I am still persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day? You can't get me out of here that easily, because God is still my light and my salvation. People, come on, church. You can't get me out of here that easily, because God is still the strength of my life. You can't get me out of here that quickly, because God is still my shepherd. I shall not want. And because I know how to feel him, he is my resistance, he is my restraint, and he is my reinforcement.
I'm done. He said, I must guard the call with the fear of God. So you know what I do? Verse number 16 says it. Because I fear the Lord, I have devoted myself to the work on the wall. You see, I wish I had a church inside here. My Baptist people have, and my friends from Canaan are not here. I know why they're this quiet. It's because they're in a Baptist church. Nehemiah said, I devoted myself. Come on, church. And the best way of putting it is, it didn't matter what else was happening around me. Come on, church. It doesn't matter what else. It didn't matter what else was going on in front of me. I just dedicated myself to the work on the wall. Now, again, this church, I am getting a zero from them people, you know. Sister Pauline, make we talk. Eh? In a matter what drop in our way, in a matter what we are going through, there is a purpose for which God has called us. And that purpose requires our 100% attention. Do I have somebody yet now? I'm going to get out of your way, church. And that's why, Sister Pauline, all when sickness take we still keep our eyes on the wall. And even when death walks in the family, we still keep our attention on the wall. And even when we have no money and we're broke like church mouse, we still keep our eyes on the wall. And even when our Sambalats and our Tobias are giving us hell in the background, we still keep our eyes on the wall, because I know where I am going. I know where I am going, for where I am going, joy bells are ringing, happy children are singing. I know where I am going. I know. I don't care what your name is, where you are from. If God has given you a mandate, if God has given you a mission, if God has dropped a purpose in your heart, keep your eyes on the wall. Let them say what they want to say. Do what they want to do. Laugh how they want to laugh at you. But still keep your eyes on the wall. Because there is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky. No tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be. When my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace, when he take me by the hand and lead me to the promised land. I'm finished. Me can't do like the rest of Uno. That's what he said. Because I fear God. And because I fear God, I have to keep my eyes on the work of God, to the glory of God. Somebody say hallelujah. Come on, somebody shout hallelujah. 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 We're a little late, so we're going to go straight to the congregational prayer. And I'm going to invite Reverend Courtney Walters to lead us in that prayer as we stand. Our responses are going to be sung, okay? So just look, follow in your order, and then we'll come back. Can you lead us?
Let us stand for the prayer. Gracious and loving God, giver of life, we, the people of faith, turn to you in the midst of loss and pain. Heavenly Father, you are our refuge and strength. Help and comfort us today, increase our faith, dispel our fears, revive our hope. May the Holy Spirit lift us from the darkness of our grief to the light of your presence through Jesus Christ our Lord. We bring to you our thanks for the service of your son, Kelvin, to the people of Jamaica. Through his stewardship as a member of the Jamaica Constabulary Force, we praise you for all who were guided and guarded by him. We place before you the men and women of the Jamaica Constabulary Force who have and are contributing to the protection of your people, those who stand on the wall and commit to be safety to the safety and security of your people. Watch over them, we pray. Loving God, Grant to us all now the grace to turn back to turn back our lives and our task with calm hearts, minds at peace, and a renewed faith. As we mourn the passing of Kelvin, help us preserve and protect his legacy, support his family, and play our part in the development of our country. Lord of all, we praise you for all who have entered into their rest and reached the promised land where you are seen face to face. Give us grace to follow in their footsteps as they followed in the way of your Son. Thank you for the memory of those you have called to yourself. By each memory, turn our hearts from things seen to things unseen, and lead us till we come to the eternal rest you have prepared for your people through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, sing, for the night is o'er. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore.
Let the church say amen. Praise God. I tell you that even at a funeral service, we can still praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Right. We want you to adhere to the following instructions as we, you can be seated. You can be seated. You can be seated. We want you to adhere to the following instructions as we make our way to the place of interment. We will be facilitated today by outriders who will be leading the procession. But let me begin with how we will leave the church. The platform party, the ministers, and I'm going to be asking the choir members to leave first, all right? So I'm going to be asking members on the choir to leave first. Then the platform party officiating ministers will then leave, after which I'm going to be asking the past members, retired members, to make your way, because they'll be the pallbearers from the church to the hearse that is on the outside. The JCF personnel will be assisting us with the collection of the wreaths that are here, and then the immediate family members, you'll make your way to your vehicles. I ask that we pay close attention to the outriders as they'll be given instructions in terms of the pathway, in terms of the direction that we will take, and the speed at which we will travel. So members who are present, I invite you, when the time is ready, when we're ready, when you get on the outside, please make your way quickly to your vehicles so we can make our way to the place of interment. I invite you at this time to stand with us as we will employ the hymn of recession, God is my keeper. At this time, at the start of the first verse, I invite the choir to make your way down. So choir members, As we begin to sing, you can make your way down.
So who shall I be afraid? God is my keeper. Lord. So who shall I fear? So whom shall I be afraid?
Past members.
God is my keeper. God is my guide in my resting and my rising. So whom shall I fear? Is my guide when I step out and forward in. So whom shall I be? God is my keeper. God is my guide when the Philistines come upon me. So whom shall I fear? He is my guide when my enemies come to devour I. So whom shall I be afraid? God is my keeper. God is my guide from the Philistines of darkness. So whom shall I fear? He is my guide from the vampires of hell. So whom shall I be afraid? God is my keeper. God is my health and my strength. So whom shall I fear? He is my shield upon my right and my left hand. So whom shall I be afraid? God is my keeper.